I always think there's something a bit contrived when Pastor Krusen goes on vacation when there are texts like this that pop up. Well, in the Bible Boost earlier this week, I mentioned that there is a bunny who has been living in our backyard for several years, and we've lovingly named him Walter. Well, it turns out Walter has made a friend, because now there are little bunnies around our yard. At first, I thought it was just one, but I have noticed now more than one little baby bunny hopping around. Well, just this past week, I was watching Little Tulip, as my children have named one of them, and I started to think about babies. You know, the symbol of new life. So exciting. They have all of this life before them. Babies are a reminder of possibility and of hope and dreams. But it also reminded me that we all have new life before us, not just when we are little babies. In our baptism, in the waters of the font, we have been joined to Christ in life and in death. And that means every day we have the possibility of new life. See, every day people die of violence or addiction or poverty. And every day people are raised to new life through love and relationships and serving. But I wonder if we have lost that focus. Are we so tired and so busy that we have lost the excitement of new life in Christ? A pastor once said, too many Christians are betweeners, living between Egypt and Canaan, saved but never satisfied. Or they live between Good Friday on the cross and Easter in the empty tomb. They believe in the cross, but they don't enter into the power and the glory of the resurrection. Today and every day, we are invited to enter into the power and the glory of the resurrection. Today and every day, we are invited to feel the real presence and peace of God and to walk with Christ. But of course, sometimes walking with Christ seems more confusing or frightening than it does glorious. I mean, Jesus' words in today's gospel reading are not very reassuring for us, are they? We hear things like, I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Or, I have come to set a man against his father and a daughter against her mother. Or, whoever loves father and mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. How is a text about wielding swords and family feuds relevant to our entering into the glory of a new life that we have in Christ? These are surprising words. They're surprising because we still frame our life in Christ within our cultural lives, rather than considering how our cultural lives fit within our life in Christ. I actually appreciate how Reverend Dr. Delmer Chilton unpacked this. He shared an experience he had with a young woman who came to his office to see him. And standing there, she pointed at one of the diplomas on his office wall and asked her, what is spiritual direction? Well, at first, he fumbled around for an answer, but finally said something like, well, people come in to see me, and I listen to them talk about their life. sort of like going to a counselor, but instead of whatever a therapist might say, a spiritual director tries to help people find where God is in their life. And the woman responded, "How funny. I should think it would be more important for them to figure out where they are in God's life." Reverend Dr. Chilton says things change when we turn that question around, don't they? Rather, instead of asking, "What is God doing to make my life better or more whole or more spiritual?" the real question is, "What am I doing to involve myself in the work and the will of God in the world today?" That is what it means to enter into the power and the glory of the resurrection. Seen in this light, the scary things that Jesus said actually make perfect sense. I mean, if you're going to go with Jesus, you've got to go all the way. If you're going to go with Jesus, you have to be prepared to choose the kingdom of God over your neighbors, over your family. And perhaps the most important is even choosing the kingdom of God over yourself. And that's just not an easy choice to make. Indeed, both the gospel and our reading in Romans describe it as a choice that is compared to death. Matthew says, "Those who lose their life for my sake will find it." And Paul writes, "We were baptized into Christ's death, and our old self was crucified with him, and we have been united with Christ in a death like his." Yes, following Jesus is not so much about finding where God is in our life. It's more about finding those places where we are called to be in God's life, what we are called to do in the kingdom of God. Ultimately, the hard, crazy, scary things that Jesus has said to us today, while they are still hard, maybe are not so crazy or not so scary at all. You see, they're not crazy because they tell a true thing about life. A true thing that everyone needs to learn in order to be truly and completely human. And that thing is, it isn't about you. It's not about you and how many people like you. It's not about you and your wonderful family. It's not about you and your successful and prosperous life. It's just not. And paradoxically, the sooner one learns this, the happier one is. Of course, our ego says, "Well, if it's not about us, then what is it about?" It's about God and God's love for the entire world, for the whole creation, from the hairs on each of our heads and the life of the sparrows to the fate of the earth and the future of the whole human race. It's all about God and God's will and God's way and our place in that grand movement into God's promised tomorrow. We are called to be a part of this new heaven and new earth that God is actively creating now. New life today. And the things that Jesus says are not scary because they contain within them the promise of resurrection. The promise that we will also be a part of the new thing that God is doing. Those who lose their life will find it, Matthew says. And in Romans, we are reminded that we will certainly be united with Christ in a resurrection like his. In today's gospel lesson, Jesus invites us to take up a cross and follow him. And he's not very specific about that. He doesn't provide a contract or a job description. Rather, he invites us to just give it all up. All of it. And follow. He invites us to enter into the glory and the power of the resurrection. The glory and the power that gives us new life each and every day. God does not want us to be so tired and so busy that we lose the excitement and the refreshment and the joy of the life given to us in baptism. But I see that fatigue everywhere. Just this past week, a friend of mine posted on Facebook a simple statement. She said, "Somebody please tell me something good that's happening in our society." In this statement, I heard such desperation and lack of hope. And why not? I mean, every day wars are being fought, bombs are being dropped, children go hungry, people run from their homes and their nations because they're being persecuted for what they believe or what they don't believe. And people still die simply because of the color of their skin. What in the world is there to be hopeful about? Well, then I read the comments, and I saw new life. New life was witnessed at a U2 concert, as the people gathered were invited to participate in the Red Project, where the organization has partnered with certain brands to give up to 50% of their profits to help provide HIV medicines to millions of people across Africa. New life was witnessed as a group of people planted a community garden to help support neighborhood food insecurity programs. New life is witnessed as Habitat for Humanity continues to build homes. New life is witnessed as manna continues to feed the hungry. And I just witnessed new life yesterday as 30 plus youth and adults left from this congregation to begin their journey to some of the poorest parts of Appalachia to help make homes warmer and drier and safer, homes of strangers. Strangers who are just family they have yet to meet. This new life is all around us, and it is within us. The invitation is there to enter into the glory and the power of the resurrection today, to give up ourselves and live for God. How will you respond to that invitation today? Amen.